I'm Lori Conroy, and I am a teacher specialist with the special education department, and I specialize with the preschool program. I support them. I taught preschool for 15 years at Manitas, so I'm fairly familiar with the process and the program. I want to let you know that this is being videotaped to be put on YouTube for parents who are not able to make it. So if you have questions specific to your child, you might want to keep names out of it or hold your question until we're done videotaping.
I'm Candy Race, and I teach kindergarten currently at Estrella. And I've taught kindergarten for years and years and years, taught second, third, fifth, sixth, fourth kindergarten.
Our agenda today is to talk about, first of all, kindergarten for all students and what we do to help them be successful as they make that shift from preschool to kindergarten. And then we'll take any questions along the way, and then also at the end. And then once we're done with that, we'll go ahead and talk about the process for children who are receiving special education services, and then answer questions along the way and then anything at the end. This is being put on by the KSEPAC, which is the Kyrene Special Education Parent Advisory Council. And we have a form to fill out at the end if you could do so and let us know if you have any further questions or if you'd like more information about KSEPAC or coming to meetings where you get information about special education, network with other parents. It's a great organization. So that's who's putting it on. This is our agenda. And we'll get started. The purpose of the transition process is to make sure that all kids have a successful start to kindergarten. And parents, because it's a scary and exciting time for you and your child, and we want to make sure that everybody's ready and has whatever supports in place that they need to be successful. Who's eligible for kindergarten? Anybody who turns 5 by September 1st. You don't have to know your alphabet to be able to start kindergarten. You don't need to write your name to start kindergarten. You have to be 5 by this date. If you have a child who is 5 between September 1st and December 31st, and you're interested in the early entrance program, there is a meeting you need to attend, and there's information on the Kyrene website. This whole presentation will be available, the PowerPoint as well, so the link will be there for you if you're interested in that. Does anybody fall into that category? Okay. Candy's gonna talk about kindergarten in general, some of the curriculum, some of the things to expect. And answer questions along those lines to that order.
So first bullet point, there's this curriculum and standards. And first thing you might want to know is that by and large across the United States, the movement, the shift in the paradigm has been to adopt Common Core state standards. And what they're really talking about there is that they are trying to homogenize the expectations for all grade levels. And this is a study that was conducted in order to reverse engineer what incoming college students need to be able to do to succeed. They asked that question and they took it back down to all the grade levels and they distilled it down to the essential skills that each student needs to have at a particular grade level. So if you go to the Arizona Department of Education website, you will find there what they call the Common Core Standards. We have renamed them in Arizona College and Career Readiness Standards. And so different name, same idea. Which basically boils down to, if I am a kindergartner in Maryland and I'm learning certain things, if I move mid-year to Arizona or to New Mexico or Montana, I'm still going to be held accountable for the same standards and the same exit outcomes as a kindergartner. They were finding that the standards were so different across our country that children were struggling to maintain what they were learning at a particular grade level at a particular time. So, all teachers are held to a set of curriculum and standard outcomes. Everybody knows where we're sailing the ship to. Everybody knows how to succeed and what those successes will look like. As far as a typical kindergartner's day, they're going to be seeing all areas of curriculum, reading, writing, math, science, social studies, and health. They're going to be looking at all areas of general studies, the same standards that you'll see there listed. That's what we're teaching to. And so Lori hit on an important point. It's like while they're busy doing that, it doesn't mean that they need to come into kindergarten with any set standards or set capabilities. What you need to know is that kindergartners come to us in a wide variety of skill sets. Some kids can come in and they're busy reading already. It just made sense to them and it's just clicked and they've got it. Some children come in and they don't yet know a letter from a number. And we're going to take every child wherever they are, and we're going to move them forward as quickly and as capably as we can while they're feeling successful and while we're moving them at a pace that's just right for them. And we'll get to talking more a little bit about how we do that and the ways that we group children in order to help them succeed where they are. There are special classes. We all enjoy art and music and PE and library. Our district is very fortunate in that we have tons of technology at our disposal, and we are using it daily. Our children are entering an era where the jobs that they're going to do haven't really even been imagined yet, more than likely. So our district, being forward-thinking, has really put their money where their mouth is and gotten a huge wealth of technology at our fingertips. I know that for my kindergarten grade level, we were fortunate enough to receive a cluster of 10 iPads per classroom. And so the kids are just steeped in technology whenever they need it and however they need it. So it's a great thing. Having said that, I know that as a parent of a preschooler coming into kindergarten, you're probably sitting there thinking, what I really want to know is how my child is going to get from the bus to the playground and not die, not get lost, not get wounded. I want to know that it's going to be okay. What kindergarten teachers and preschool teachers want you to know is that our concern for your children's safety and welfare is at our best interest and at our heart too. So at the beginning of the school year, when I'm teaching kindergarten, I figure day one, it's great if we have a couple of great stories. We get to the playground, we figure out where the cafeteria is, and everybody stays together. And everybody goes home dry. That's a bonus day for us at the beginning. So while it sounds like we're going to be doing nuclear physics by day two, that's not really a true assessment. That's not a true measure of the experience. But what we want you to know is that in your mind or in your experience, what you were doing in first and second grade, we're seeing a lot of that has moved down into the kindergarten realm. And so it is rigorous and it is far-reaching, but it's doable, and the kids really rise to the occasion. It's a really good experience for them. Sure. Yes. Lori was asking me about the curriculum and standards. If you drive yourself to on your computer to the Arizona Department of Ed, the Common Core standards are there for anyone to read and to look at. You're going to find that it's in everyday language. You'll be able to understand exactly what it is your child is being asked to do. You can go all the way up through the grades and look at that. One thing that's a shift for children right now is that at third grade level, we will be there's high stakes testing going on all across the country, and that just means that there are standardized tests that are still being given. They're shifting the type of tests that are being given. They're moving to a test that's called the PARC. And the difference in that test that maybe you and I were familiar with is that it's no longer just about bubbling in an answer or having the right choice or just getting to the right answer. Moreover, it's about how did you get to that answer? So even in the realm of math or science or social studies, they will be asking students to talk about their thinking and write about their thinking. So in science, you may need to justify how you came to your conclusion. In mathematics, you may need to discuss thoroughly why you use a certain algorithm that you chose to use. And they're looking at building students who are thinkers, who are capable of reasoning and using their integration of skills. It's not about this slicing and dicing up of curriculum into this is math and now we're doing science and now we're doing social studies. What they're doing is they're really weaving that together thoroughly. So those standards are there for you on the Arizona Department of Education's website. And we're all moving toward that integration of knowledge for students to be successful.
So some of the things that you can do to help make the transition smooth for your child would be making sure that there's good communications between home and school. So wanting to talk with your preschool teacher about the things that you feel your child may need in kindergarten, wanting to talk with them about maybe what kind of setting that your child may need. The schools typically have a form that comes out around spring break that's called an environmental request form, where you can talk about what environment you feel best meets your child's needs or that they best learn in. Many times parents would come to me and say, which teacher should I ask for? that's not what we need to know. We need to know what environment. So if you have that question for your classroom teacher, you might say, what environment do you think is best for my child? Because you know your child best overall. Your teacher knows how your child functions in school and what supports they need and what kind of structure they may need. So that would be a really good conversation to have. The preschool teams will provide the kindergarten teams with information about your child, no matter what their needs are. I've had teachers from other schools call me and say, hey, you have this child, what can you tell me to help them be successful? Or what worked with this child well? Which leads into this form that we fill out called What Works. And this form is filled out for children who need something beyond just the general what happens throughout the day to support kids. Maybe your child's really fidgety and active and they need something to play with at circle to be successful. Maybe they need to be able to sit at circle for a little bit and then take a quick walk around the room in order to refocus themselves. So what kinds of strategies can be put in place to help? This is not filled out for every child, only those children that we need to do those extra things for to help them be successful. And of course, if there's any meetings on your child, you want to attend those. Along those lines, you're going to want to get to know your home school and prepare your child. Your child may attend preschool at the school that they will attend kindergarten, but maybe not. So if not, you're going to want to sign up for the home school's listserv, and that's on the front page of the Kyrene homepage, where you can get, does anybody get listserv now for their school? Okay, so there's lots of different listservs you can get. The benefit of doing that is when your school has an orientation or a get to know your kindergarten program event or a community event like a sock hop, you'll know about that and you can attend. Even if your child's not enrolled at the school, you could go to a sock hop or a carnival or something of that nature so that your child gets familiar with that campus. The kindergarten orientation night is January 23rd. That will be at all schools at 6:30. Some schools may have events for children while the parents are in a meeting, so you'll want to watch for that information or call the school and find out. You're going to want to attend Meet the Teacher Night, which hopefully you did for preschool. And then you may ask the principal if you can visit the school with your child so they become familiar with the layout of the school and the playground and whatnot. Some of the things that we do on our end, of course, we communicate, like I've already talked about, with staff. Many preschool teachers will set up times to take the children into a kindergarten classroom for a story, to tour the class, to just see what it's all about. More towards April or May, they may just take in a few kids at a time and get to experience what a kindergarten classroom is all about to help ease that anxiety a little bit. So, are there any questions about those issues or topics? Just know, whatever we're doing, we all have your child's best interest in mind. We have worked with your children and gotten to know them and come to love them and want what's best for them, as do you. So we're all working for the best interest of the child. And if things aren't working in the setting or with the classroom or your child's having trouble adjusting, call, ask the teacher for a meeting, communicate with them, have, revisit what you guys have discussed. And then make sure to allow for that adjustment period for your child and for you. So, and you touched on some good points this morning with that, if you want to jump in on that.
Yeah, as far as the amount of time. Mm-hmm. I can speak from the kindergarten teacher bringing in those new preschool students, and oftentimes, especially if you have a child who's exceptional in one or several ways, it's challenging to not want to give it a fair amount of time. I know I had one student a few years ago, and he was thrice exceptional, so super student, but mom was super anxious and was super engaged, and there almost wasn't any oxygen in the room, if you know what I mean. And he needed to be given a chance just to try his wings out a little bit. I would encourage you to try to take a step back and let your child have those first couple of weeks to really get to know their teacher and to get to know their environment. Oftentimes we have parents who want to come in right away and volunteer, I'm here for you, and they're used to that preschool environment where it's just, they're all hands on deck most of the time, and that's not a bad thing. But what you will probably find in most cases is that the kindergarten teacher will ask you to give them a couple of weeks just to have kind of a no appearance in the room environment so that your child gets to know the environment, gets to know the procedures, gets comfortable with them as their teacher. And then there will come a time when that volunteer schedule will come out and there will be plenty of opportunity for you to volunteer. Believe me, don't disappear, because we need you desperately. We love having parents come in the classroom. But it is essential at the beginning of the school year for teachers to have those first couple of weeks. It's really a lot about procedure and how does this world of kindergarten work. And so you really need to give your kids that time to assimilate and clip those wings just a little bit and try out some of that independence that they're going to be getting over the course of the kindergarten year. So, core curriculum and supports. We spoke about the common core standards, the expectations that your child will have. Yes, there is an expectation that they will leave us really either reading or ready to read. They will leave us knowing sight words. They will leave us knowing how to write some ideas on paper with some illustrations, and probably even more than that. They will have a really strong foundation in phonemic awareness. They will have a strong foundation in numeration, in counting, in subitizing. They'll have huge math underpinnings, and they will have lots going on by the time they leave us in kindergarten. But to get there, it really does take the entire culture, the entire school. If you are, especially those who might be concerned about their children, having enough support, I call that scaffolding, ways to give that child support and lift them up. What you need to know is that already in your building, there exists all types of structure, all kinds of programs, all kinds of people with fabulous resources to help shore up the teacher, help reassure you with your child, help provide extra hands-on, extra support. Instructional focus groups are already in place across the district. It's just a way of teachers looking at children in different ways and in different settings. If you think back to when there was the one-room schoolhouse environment, that teacher had to be on her game because she had kids K through 8, everybody had a different need. She had to know exactly where every child was at and what their needs were at that moment and provide for them. We moved away from that. The paradigm shifted to, let's put all these four-year-olds together. Let's put all these five-year-olds together. It kind of got homogenized to where we were thinking, well, everybody pretty much needs to be doing the same thing at all times. But if we think about that, that's not really fair either, because just as I said, I have some kids coming in who are ready for War and Peace just about, and I have some kids who are like, I just want to go dig in the dirt. I just want to go have a great time and bust this open and see what's inside, you know? So everybody's a little bit different. So we've looked at that and we've said, well, if we want these kids to be uber ready for things like college and their career, and we figured out how that looks at the kindergarten level, what do we need to have them doing? Well, that means as professionals, we need to be subdividing our children in many different ways. That might mean that I'm putting light groups of children together for a reading lesson. That might mean that I'm teaching whole group on certain subjects. That might mean I have kids in diptychs or triptychs, groups of twos and threes. It could look many different ways across the course of a day in any given classroom across our district. So we are asked at two different times during the day for math and reading to work with kids by specific needs so that we're grouping them with exactly, drilling down to exactly what it is that they need at that moment for math or for reading. You also have a wealth of support in people like the K-3 teachers, and they are there to specifically support that early literacy, that early reading, phonics, phonemic awareness, building comprehension, building fluency, helping to build vocabulary. And those folks are already in the building working right now. So if your child has a special area of need, there are extra hands and extra eyes and minds to help the teacher in the classroom and even outside of the classroom. I would let you know that if your child is given the opportunity to work with a K-3 teacher, it's an awesome opportunity. Again, it's driven by student need. As we assess them, we'll say, well, this child certainly needs a little bit more on this or that. I would wish that every one of my children in my classroom could have the advantage of their expertise. It's a really strong program. The same thing happens for math. We have math coaches and literacy coaches in every building across the district. They're another layer that's provided for classroom teachers so that when that teacher has a specific need for a particular lesson, some material or an idea for a particular lesson, they're there to shore up the teachers and thus the children. And across the buildings and across the district, you have a wealth of professionals who are wise enough, as Lori was saying, to make that phone call to somebody across the district and say, hey, this is what I need. Can you help me with that? Making a phone call to previous teachers and saying, what were the strategies that worked for this little one? Because I'm not sure I'm right on the money with this child and I need some help. And then across the district in every building, there is going to be a program called PBIS, which is Positive Behavior Interventions and Supports. And basically that's looking at, instead of our approach being punitive in nature, we're looking at ways to encourage kids to make great choices, to become socially aware, to become fabulous human beings. At Estrella, we're the Estrella Star, so we are taking responsibility and showing respect. That's our little mantra that we use all the time. And we have star slips, and we catch kids doing fabulous things, and we have assemblies where we're supporting and encouraging the great things that are happening in our building. So you will find that across the district as well. Okay, questions with that before I leap ahead?
Okay, so just some general information about kindergarten. At this point, assume you'll be going to your home school. Some people are attached to their preschool site and really want to stay there even if it's not their home school. Please still register at your home school. This helps us to project numbers of students coming so we can staff appropriately. If you have neighbors, friends, people you meet in the grocery store with kids coming to kindergarten, make sure they register. Numerous times, every beginning of the year, we have to find a kindergarten teacher at the last minute because people haven't registered until summertime or the end of summer, and it's a scramble sometimes to get that going. It works, but it just is a little bit hectic. So please get everybody you can to register for kindergarten now. If you want to go to a school other than your home school, you need to complete an open enrollment application. And that is available either downstairs at the desk where you signed in or online. And those are granted based on first come, first serve and availability in the program. A program can be kindergarten, a program can be third grade, a program can be speech language services, resource services. So you want to make sure to get those applications. If it's for early K, that's a whole nother process. You have to do the meeting and that your child goes to an evaluation. Not called an evaluation, it's an assessment.
And this is
a screening. Thank you, that's the word. They go through a screening, and from there, I believe there are two schools that have early K programs, Manitas, and what's the other one, Candy, do you know? There's one on the other side of the
freeway. I don't, we have one each side of the freeway.
Mm-hmm. Is this for half day?
No, half day is different. Half day is at Millennial currently, I believe.
What is early?
Early K is for those kids who turn 5 between September 1 and December 31st.
So it's actually a separate class from the actual case.
Same curriculum, smaller class size, kids are all within a 6-month range of age, or 4-month, I guess. So yeah, I think they try to keep those around 18 students.
Okay. So expectations are the same, but they just have more support, smaller class size.
And kids go on to first grade from there.
Right.
Yeah. So once they finish early K, they go right to first grade, like as if they were in kindergarten.
So to register, you have to go into school, or can we do
you
it
do.
Downstairs?
Okay. No, you do. And you can, at your preschool site, you can pick up the packet because the registration packet is the same throughout the district, but you need to take it to your home school with a birth certificate, immunization records, and proof of residency. Yes, ma'am.
And when does the registration packet need to be returned?
By the first day of school in August.
Okay.
The sooner the better.
Okay.
So.
What if, because where we currently live right now, we won't be there, and I don't know exactly where we're going. So should I just register him where we're supposed
yes.
to be and then change it?
Yes. Yeah. Are you going to stay within the district or you don't know that?
I'm pretty sure we are.
Yeah, go ahead and register at that school. If you apply for open enrollment, I would recommend if putting more than one school as a choice. And that way, if your first choice is, if you really don't want to go to your home school, if your first choice has, is at capacity already, they can look at your second or third choice. Yeah.
If they are currently in preschool in their home school, do I still need to enroll them
you
again?
Do. Okay. You do. You do. I wish you didn't, but it's a different entity. Okay, so we will move on now to the special education process. So the special education process is a little bit more involved because we want to make sure that we're really ready for your kids. The homeschool team knows your child's needs. So the purpose of the process is to set up the best program to meet your child's individual needs. We also need to determine eligibility for kindergarten. We want to ensure that success for the student and the staff and the school and the parent. We want to share information with the elementary school staff and then ensure that all the supports are in place for the child. Who's eligible for kindergarten? Anybody who turns 5 by September 1st. You don't have to know your alphabet to be able to start kindergarten. You don't need to write your name to start kindergarten. You have to be 5 by this date. If you have a child who is 5 between September 1st and December 31st, and you're interested in the early entrance program, there is a meeting you need to attend and there's information on the Kyrene website. This whole presentation will be available, the PowerPoint as well, so the link will be there for you if you're interested in that. Does anybody fall into that category? Okay. The purpose of transition, okay. So the process has begun on our end. Our first job is that we notify the home school of what students are coming. We send out, we being me, sends out a schedule to the teams for the review of existing data meeting, which we're going to talk about each of these meetings in detail. Then you're going to have an evaluation if it's needed. You're going to have a meeting called the Multidisciplinary Educational Team Meeting to discuss the evaluation and category of eligibility if your child continues to be eligible. If so, then you're going to have an IEP meeting. So decisions are made as a team, and you are a critical part of that team. So it's not the school coming in and saying, here's what we need to do. It's working together to discuss what's best. So the review of existing data, this is your very first meeting and this should take place prior to spring break, probably in February, maybe beginning end of January. This meeting is the red meeting. We talk about what do we know about your child? What are their strengths? What are their needs? What has helped them be successful? What else do we need to know about your child to determine eligibility, to find out which of those 13 categories they best fit into? And what's our plan? How are we going to collect this data? What testing are we going to do? And when will it be done by? Well, it has to be done within 60 days, but it could be earlier than that.
And will they contact us to set this up?
Yes.
Okay.
Your preschool teacher should be getting a hold of you shortly, hopefully in the next week, to let you know the day and time. We have set out, because we have almost 100 students transitioning to 25 schools, so it becomes a scheduling difficulty sometimes. It's a lot of work. So we send out a schedule saying, Bree says, here's how many kids you have from which schools. Here's your date to do your red meetings. So if you can make that date, make it work in your schedule to make that date and time, it's really helpful, especially if you have an OT coming or a vision specialist from the district, because the more people involved, the more difficult it is to find a common time. If you can't make that meeting, of course, we'll work to come up with a time that works for everybody. So you should be hearing, hopefully, by next week when that meeting should be. And the teacher should already have a tentative date, but not a time, so you can even ask them if you want to block that off on your calendar. after the red, if it's determined that you're going to do an evaluation, and if your child's evaluation is over a year old, it is best practice to redo that evaluation because children change so much at this age. Many times children come in at 3, and by the time we go to kindergarten, they're a totally different child. So it's really important to get current information. So, and part of that evaluation could be some intelligence testing, some IQ testing, some achievement testing, some rating scales, parent interviews, looking at records. If you have any outside paperwork that's current or evaluations, that's helpful information to give to the staff. So the next meeting, the multidisciplinary evaluation team meeting, or MET, is where you talk about the data. What did this evaluation show us? What do we know? And once we look at that data, you determine, does the child still qualify for special education services? And if so, under which category? So which best describes, maybe your child has a vision impairment and autism. So the team's going to talk about, of those two categories, what best describes your child's needs. And that's going to be something that you discuss as a team to determine. Sometimes there's only one area that really fits, and so there's not a lot of discussion. If your child has a speech language impairment and no other delays, then it's pretty cut and dry. If it's determined your child still qualifies for special education services, you will have an IEP meeting, individual education program, which you all are familiar with. The thing that differs with this meeting is that, or this document, is that your present levels are going to talk about your child. When you get to goals, when you get to least restrictive environment, services that will be provided, that's going to look a little different because you're going to have information about preschool and then information about kindergarten because the document is good for a year's time. So it's going to be covering that whole span. Does that make sense? Okay. If your child does not continue to be eligible for services in kindergarten, they can continue to come to preschool for the remainder of the school year because we don't believe it's best for kids to say in April, you no longer qualify. You get to go on your merry way and you don't get to finish out a year with your peers. So they will continue to stay in preschool. In your IEP for kindergarten, you're going to talk about the least restrictive environment. We need to look at how successful can the child be in achieving their goals on the IEP and meeting their needs in the general education classroom with supports or without supports. And what would those supports look like? Do they need to be pulled out into the resource room to get some service to help them meet those goals? Do they need some time with a speech language path coming into the classroom to work on some of those social skills? Or does your child require even more supports in an extended resource classroom? Sometimes we call it a self-contained. And this is a classroom where all the children have developmental delays or special needs identified. There are a higher ratio of adult kids, so usually 3 adults, maybe 8 to 10 children. And then the children get most of their instruction in this program, and they go out to the general education program as appropriate, maybe for story time or music, whatever's appropriate for your child and whatever helps them to meet their goals and is specified in the IEP. If that is an option that you think is being considered by the team, there will be an opportunity to observe in that program so that you know what it looks like and you can go into the meeting with information and be knowledgeable. Any questions on that part? Once the IEP is written, you go on your way, you start kindergarten, we will do the What Works plan for your child. We'll continue to communicate with that homeschool team to make sure that your child's needs are met and work with you that way. So questions on that, or it was overwhelming, you can always contact me. My contact information is on the first slide, right here. And again, you can contact your preschool teacher too.
What if you're sitting on the fence about having a transition into kindergarten? That's pretty much
in terms of if you're ready for your child to go to kindergarten?
Yeah. I mean, you presented a really nice support system, I think, and it's really well informed. And I was happy to see that because I have no idea about kindergarten, but we were considering with holding them for a year, and that's because their birthday falls right on the 1st of August.
Uh-huh.
So they aren't meeting the criteria for the September early K.
Right.
They're just right there at the very end.
That's a decision that you as a parent have to make. We're still going to go through this process. We're going to have an IEP ready to implement if your child still requires it. We're going to have that IEP ready to implement the first day of school. If you opt to not go to kindergarten, you cannot come back to preschool because you're kindergarten
Correct.
Eligible, and then you won't be receiving any special ed services. So that's something you have to weigh out.
So if they continue on their year and we still do the IEP and we decide not to put them in, the following January, I would go through this whole process and come to this meeting and try to...
You'd already have an IEP in place. You wouldn't need to come here. You would contact the school and say,
and
we have this IEP. The IEP is likely expired, so you would probably work with the school psychologist to go from there and figure out what the next steps are.
Okay.
Yes?
I guess I have a more of a general question. I have twins, and one has an IEP and one doesn't, because the one twin relies on the other twin. Is there a special form I should fill out if I don't want them in the same class?
Yes, you're going to go to the front office of the homeschool, and you're going to fill out an environmental request form. And that probably won't be available till right after spring break, but you can ask the office when you register. Open enrollment for children with disabilities. You're going to go ahead and fill out your form and submit it. The sooner the better, because they're date stamped and they're looked at in the order in which they were received. I talked about this a little bit before, but if you say your homeschool is Manitas and you really want your child to go to Cielo, what we're going to look at is, A, is their kindergarten program at capacity? If it is, we can't grant open enrollment. If there is space in their kindergarten program, what supports does your child need? Do they need speech-language services, resource services, and are those programs at capacity? And if they are, then it can't be granted because they have to service their children who attend there, that's a homeschool. So if you're looking, again, at a school at the new homeschool, I would put multiple choices on the form. Any other questions? So watch from your preschool teacher for a couple things to come, your red date, and then also a date where we're going to be setting up times to observe in those extended resource programs if you're considering that for your child or thinking you want to know more about what that looks like. And then also we can, at that same time, we'll go look at a resource room. So. Any questions? You guys were a quick group.